Hey, what's going on, Facebook Live family? It's your boy, Brother Leon. I'm coming to you with another video. I know you guys are probably getting ready for the Super Bowl. And I ain't gonna lie, man. If you up here looking for chicken wings right about now, or meatballs right about now, yo, man, the rush is on. But I want to talk to you tonight. I'm not going to be before you long. I need a shave, too. I just want to talk to you tonight, man, because I ain't gonna lie. We're at the 31st day of January. We were at the 31st day of January. And I ain't gonna lie. You know, some of us are probably like, yo, Lord, I could get a do-over. I'm serious. Some of us could actually get a do-over because, you know, our year is not starting the way we want it to. You know what I mean? And I get it. Let me turn this music down a little bit. Hold on for a sec. And the music that I got playing right now is Charge It To My Head. It's by Commission. So this is from their... Wow, this album came out in 99. Times and Season. Right now, they are on a reunion tour. So I'm going to tell you, man. Yo, if you can get tickets to that Commission show, yo, take it. Get it. Watch them. Because I'm going to tell you, man, these guys have been around for the longest. And the crazy part about them, man, they are old school. And I love the fact that, you know, Fred Hammond came from Commission. And he went on, you know, Radical for Christ. And now he's doing his own thing. But I'm going to tell you, man, yo, Commission is the truth. And the song that I got going right now is called Charge It To My Head. Like I say, in all my other videos, I do not own any of the rights to this music. But, you know, I want you guys to understand and know that a lot of us are saying it don't make sense. You know, it just don't make sense. It don't make sense, you know, how some things happen. But the one thing that I want you to understand and know, for those of us who may be intercessors and those of us who may be praying, is that a lot of times, man, it don't make sense. I'm serious. A lot of prayers that I've prayed for other people, I'm like, Lord, what happened? You know, my faith was there. I know the faith was there. The spirit was there. The word was there. We confessed and everything like that. But it just didn't happen the way that we wanted it to happen. And a lot of times, man, we as men and women of God and as intercessors and as prophetic people, we have to get to the place, or even if our prayers and stuff for other people are not working or they're not being answered, that God is still sovereign, that God is still good. And, you know, you can't take it personal. I'm serious. You cannot take it personal, because a lot of us, man, we will take certain things personal and we will internalize it and think that it's us. And a lot of times, no, it's not you. You know, it's not the fact that you didn't pray. You did pray. It's not the fact that you weren't standing on the word. Some of us are standing on the word. Man, we can quote the scriptures. But a lot of times, man, when it comes to people, you got to understand that people's will are involved. You got to also understand that when it comes to a place of healing and deliverance, that people they got to want it more than you. Seriously, they got to want it more than you, because here's the thing. I could pray for you, but the remedy, my prayers for you will help get you into agreement. And at times God will give us miracles. I will say that. But I will say this. Your prayers are answered more by you than they are by me. And God hears you more, and you hear you more than you do me at times. But a lot of times, some of us, you know, if you ever get sick, I'm going to tell you this right now. You got to want healing more than the people that are praying for you. You got to want deliverance more than the people that are standing for you. Because when you take accountability, when you take responsibility for your own prayers, for your own healing, for your own deliverance, God hears that. And that thing will begin to work for you. If you look at the woman with the issue of blood, she said within herself. And I think a lot of times we forget that. We forget the fact that sometimes we can answer our own prayers. We forget the fact that sometimes it's up to us. And she took that accountability. She took that responsibility. She said within herself that if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole. And she touched the hem of God's garment, of Jesus' garment, virtue went out of him. She was healed. He said, who touched me? And the disciples was like, Lord, all these people all over you. They frogging you. Well, you know, forgive me for my misspeech. But, you know what I mean. And then he saw the woman. He was like, woman, thy faith has made thee whole. And so what I want you guys to understand and know, we are in a time of grieving, for our celebrities, even for our family members. But you can't allow that thing to put you in a state of guilt, to put you in a state of grief. And a lot of times, man, it don't make sense. I ain't gonna lie, that whole thing with Kobe Bryant hurt me hard, because I'm like, Lord, it don't make sense. You know, and I got to thinking about the other young celebrities. It didn't make sense about Whitney Houston. It didn't make sense about Tupac Shakur. It didn't make sense about Biggie Smalls. It didn't make sense, about Prince. It didn't make sense, over some of these young, gifted people, man, that God has graced us with, that God has made them gifts. And the one scripture that came to me was out of John. And let me stop this music. I should have been stopped this music, but I got caught up. Sorry. John chapter 5 and verse 35. He was a burning and shining light, and ye were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. And I look at the life of Kobe Bryant. I'm like, man, he was a burning and shining. That scripture is him. He was a burning and shining light, and ye were willing for a season to rejoice in his light, in his life. And then we look at, I'm just looking at, some of the commentary, some of the interviews. I think the one that probably hit me the hardest was Shaq's interview. And I ain't gonna lie, man, that thing hit hard. But I want you guys to understand and know, man, we have to lift up our NBA players. We have to lift up our celebrities, because you take away the celebrity, they just like us. And I mean, we love them because we are rejoicing in their light. We are rejoicing in what in the thing that they do for us, man. We love the fact that they overcame odds to live their dream. We love the fact that some of them come back and give back to the community. We love that. We love, how they make us feel. We love the fact that we are fans. We love the fact that, he was a part of our team, and we take that personal. And even if, even if you was on another team, and he was an opponent, you still take that personal, because, yo, man, we played against them. Or even some people, they were fans, they were all for other teams like the Knicks. Nah, hated them. But we respected him because he was the truth. And like, I'm going to read this again. He was a burning and shining light, and ye were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. And I'm not going to lie, man. This when I look at it, I'm like, Lord, it don't make sense, because in my personal opinion, that's not a full life. It's not a full life when you get married, you have a career, you retire, but your kids are young, and he won't get the chance to see none of his kids get married or graduate. And then on top of that, not only did he lose his life, but his daughter as well. And that's a sin and a shame in itself, because I'm like, Lord, I don't get that. But, I think the crazy part, and even when it comes to our relatives, it's like, Lord, I don't get it. We prayed, and I ain't gonna lie. I was like, nah, it probably might have been his helicopter, but it didn't want him. But then when the news came out, I'm like, oh, God, Lord. And the crazy part, man, his wife has to not only bury her husband, but also bury one of her children. And that's a shame. And that's why I say, man, it don't make sense. It don't make sense. When death comes this way, it doesn't make sense when tragedy strikes because of senseless violence. I was just reading today that there was a boy in the city of Wilmington who got killed by a gang. He was walking home from Howard, and he got shot. And I see the boy's picture. They had it posted on WDEL. And the crazy part about all of this is that you took the life of a 15-year-old boy, and you were only 21 and 22 years old. And I look at the faces, and I'm like, these boys got baby faces. And the crazy part about it is that your life hasn't even begun, and already you got a life term. You're going to be spending out the remainder of your days in jail, and pray to God and hope that nobody kills you in jail. Seriously. And, you know, it doesn't make sense that we don't value life. You know, it doesn't make sense to me that, you know, sometimes we pray and our prayer's not answered. Sometimes we pray for our communities and it seems like violence increases. But the one thing I do know is that God is faithful and that, you know, it's not just God who is here. But we also got to understand that there are negative forces, that there is a spiritual atmosphere outside of our home and inside of our home. And we got to begin to take authority over that. We got to begin to not only do the work spiritually, but also naturally. We got to begin, you know, this whole thing about no snitching. Yo, I'm telling you, if you won't say nothing, God be my witness. When you need somebody to speak, nobody's going to speak for you. And I'm going to give you an example. If you sleep on your friends will sleep on you. Seriously. And I'm going to give you an example. Jesus was in the boat and he was asleep in the back of the boat. And the disciples came to him and said, Lord, carest thou that we perish? And he woke up, he rebuked the winds. And when it came time for Jesus's time of need, his disciples were asleep on him. And he told them, go ahead and sleep. We're going to go through that. I'm going to go through this. But I want you to know this beyond a shadow of a doubt. When your friends need you, be there for them. Don't take rest. Don't take sleep. Do what you need to do. Do what you need to do. Do what you need to do. And so we got to get better. We got to get better in our neighborhoods. We got to begin to vote. We got to begin to be involved and not just stay in the house of God. Because a lot of times, man, we stay in the house of God. We rebuke the enemy. We, you know, cast down imaginations. We are tearing down strongholds, but we don't get out here and vote. We don't get out here and engage the culture. We don't engage at the gate. And the gate is where the laws are made. The gate is where political agendas are put into play. And that means you go down to that city hall. You go down to that city hall. And so I want you guys to know and understand that, yo, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense that we are willing to just give up our whole morals and our whole ethics because we feel as though, yo, we got a person in place who's going to get rid of the homosexual agenda. And it doesn't matter what he do, just long, you know, as he's getting it done for us. Seriously. It don't make sense. It does not make sense at all. And we are willing to change the rules. We are willing to change the laws. We are willing to say, nah, it really don't mean that when it really does. The Constitution didn't say that. There's no violation of the Constitution. Man, please. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. And I'm going to tell you, man, the Bible says this, that evil communications corrupt good manners. And the crazy part about it is that we are willing to turn a blind eye to a whole lot of stuff. And we call ourselves men and women of faith. We call ourselves, you know, that we are the high moral authority. And everybody's looking at us like, nah, man, yo, y'all greasy just like the next dude. Seriously, y'all greasy just like the next dude. And the thing is that we expect honor. We expect, you know, for you to call us spiritual father. We spiritual sons, but yet our lives are greasy. You know, our testimony is greasy. And the crazy part about it is that we have the nerve to say, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm when some of these prophets are plowing through the sheep. Seriously. Can't sit up here and say it. And I'm going to say this. I will not judge you, but you can't sit up here and say, I don't have a right to judge the fruit that you are giving off. Because I'm going to tell you, man, if you are good fruit, you're going to give forth good fruit. But if you give forth bad fruit, you're going to give forth bad fruit. And I got to call it how I see it. Seriously, I got to call it how I see it. If that fruit is bad, that fruit is bad. Don't partake of the fruit. Seriously. And, you know, I'm not trying to say personally that I judge, you know, what some of these people are doing. It's not up to me. You're going to have to stand before the Lord. But I will say this to the regular Joe and to the regular people that sit in the congregation. Don't become a victim. Don't become a victim if you're looking at TV. Don't become a victim if you're looking at Facebook Live or Instagram. Don't become a victim. Because I'm going to tell you, man, some of these people, man, they will prophesy and prophesy right to you. And tell you and put you in a place where you become victimized. And I'm going to tell you, man, that don't make no sense. That don't make no sense that we will not take responsibility, personal responsibility, to see what the Bible says about certain things. It doesn't make sense to me that we can say we need to support the men and women of God and we need to pray for our government when some of these people, man, they will not even address the issues in the black community. They won't address it at all, but they want your black dollars. Seriously. And the crazy part about it is that, you know, we swear up and down, man, that we are for this, that we are for that. And a lot of times, man, people lie. People tell you what they need to say. They tell you what you need to hear so you can get behind them. I'm serious. Politicians, preachers, all of them are like. And before there used to be an honor. There used to be a personal integrity. There used to be an ethics code among preachers, among politicians. And it was about the people. Now, man, it's about self. Yo, how can I line my pockets? You know, how can I get blessed? How can, you know, how can I? You know, not about, okay, Lord, what do you want to do? And I'm telling you right now, that is the way that it is heading. And I'm serious. And the crazy part about it, man, is that these bloggers are having a field day. These bloggers and media outlets are having a field day because I'm telling you, man, some cats out here, they greasy, greasy, big time. I'm telling you. And I'm like, man, whoo. But I will say this. I'm like, hey, look. And this is what Bishop Jordan said. He said, look, if you're struggling in an area, you be discreet until your deliverance comes. And that's what a lot of us need to do. We need to be discreet until deliverance happens. Because if we are not discreet, trust and believe, you're going to make somebody mad and that stuff going to come out. And just like I said at the beginning of this, don't make no sense. When it don't make no sense, it don't make no sense. It doesn't make any sense. But the Bible is true that these are the last days, that men will be lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, that men will be lovers of themselves more than lovers of God. And now we are getting to the place where, you know, church is just about, okay, how big can I make this? How big can I make this business? It's not even about the people anymore. It's about the business. And it's a shame because now it's like, you know, nobody knows you unless you given, you know, 5,000 and up. Don't nobody know your name if you in a big church. Seriously, if you got a church that's big, you can't keep track of that. Seriously. But now, you know, with the age of streaming and with a lot of things that are happening in the church world, people are getting to the place. Nah, man, church ain't a safe place. I'm serious. I never thought that I would see that day, but it is. You know, women are getting victimized in church. Kids are getting victimized in church. And the crazy part about it is that some of us in church want to hide it and sweep it under the rug and try to protect the so-called shepherd who done did the victimizing because we don't want to get sued. And it's a sin and a shame. But I will say this, man, we got to pray. I'm going to be like MC Hammer, we got to pray just to make it today. We have got to begin to pray. And we have got to get to the place where our conscience is not shut off. I'm telling you, man, it's a shame. It's a shame, man, about our young celebrities. It's a shame about Kobe Bryant. It's a shame about everyone. I'm serious. I was even thinking about Bruce Lee. I'm like, you know, all of those movies, man, you know, and the biggest movie that happened with him, Enter the Dragon. I know all of y'all remember that. That was the best he did. Enter the Dragon. And he ended up passing after the film of that. And then it came out 3 months after his death. And he has gotten more accolades. His estate has garnered more money, earned more money with him, you know, passing since he was alive. And the crazy part about it is that it doesn't make any sense to have that type of success and not be around to enjoy it, to have all these people sing your praise and you not even be here to see it or to enjoy it or to impart wisdom into the next generation. I'm like, yo, if Bruce Lee was living, can you imagine the movies he would be in? I'm serious. Seriously. I'm thinking to myself like, man, I would have loved to have seen Bruce Lee in The Matrix. I would have loved to have seen Bruce Lee even in Kill Bill. I'm serious. I'm like, man, you know, just looking at his life. And it doesn't make any sense. And the crazy part, that saying that goes that the good die young. You know, Heath Ledger. Oh, my God, I was hurting over that. I'm like, man, you know, you see the dark. And I mean, he got a Grammy Award for that. Whew, I was hurting over that one. Seriously, I was hurting over that one because I look at how he played the Joker. And I mean, other than Joaquin Phoenix and other than the cartoon Joker, I'm like, man, my personal opinion, yo, he locked it. He locked it down. I love Jack Nicholson, but Heath Ledger, he owned that role. I'm going to tell you that right now. But imagine the roles that he could have played in. Imagine, you know, if they would have had a sequel. Imagine, you know, what he could have been. And I'm like, man, it was too soon. It don't make no sense. I'm serious. But the one thing I will say, and I had to say this even when it came to my own personal experience with death, you know, in my family. I'm like, Lord, it don't make sense. It doesn't make sense, you know, that my mom died the way that she did and at the age that she did and at the time where I was. And it didn't make sense. But, and I'm going to say this, and I don't want anyone to get offended at what I'm getting ready to say, but that scripture that says, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. It's out of the book of Job. So if you think I'm wrong, check it out. You know, I had to learn that. And the reason why I say that the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away, blessed be the name of the Lord, is because God gave them to us as gifts. God gave them to us as gifts. And God took that gift back and we beheld the glory of the gift. We were able to partake of that gift for the time that they were here. We were able to partake of it. And what's coming to my mind right now is my first pastor, Pastor George. Man, oh my God. He was, he was a preacher preaching in the 80s, stuff that's relevant today. He was way before his time. And I look at if he was here right now, where he would be. I'm going to tell you, he would probably have the biggest church on the East Coast. I know it. I'm serious. And I look at all the people that came out of from him. Oh my God, you know, Apostle Best, whole lot of people, man, that came out of that ministry, that were sons of Pastor George, you know. And, you know, right now we're actually trying to do something to get all the members from the church, just want to come together, fellowship, do a barbecue, have a homecoming, stuff like that. But, you know, when I look at his life and I'm like, man. And the crazy part about it, you know, he left his wife, he left his kids behind. And I mean, man, it's devastating. And I ain't gonna lie, we as a church, we gotta do better because, man, we kill our own. We kill our own. We kill our own. When a man of God dies, we just act like he ain't never had no family. We act like, yo, we ain't, so, you know, they're not our responsibility. You know, his family is not our responsibility. His wife ain't our responsibility. His kids ain't our responsibility. Yes, it is your responsibility. It is. It is to make sure that they are taken care of, to make sure that they are okay. Because I look at it like this. If we say that we love that man, and if we say that we are a part of that vision that that man had, then we keep it going. And we love and we take care of what he held dearly. And I don't, you know, and the crazy part about it, the most disrespected person in the church is the first lady. It's a sin and a shame that we disrespect our first ladies that way. I'm serious. And I mean, I know that God is, you know, he's placing me in ministry. And my thing is, I'm putting up stuff because I definitely don't want my wife or my kids to be victimized, you know, by the church that say that they love me. I'm like, yo, how you going to say you love me and then you disrespect my wife? How you going to say that you love me and after I die, you trying to, you know, kick my wife out the house that the church bought for me? Or you trying to take back everything? You know what I mean? And it's crazy that we do our first ladies that way. It's crazy that we do it that way. Seriously. You know, I never thought, man, that there will have to come a day that we have to have life insurances and all types of stuff because we don't have no personal integrity to take care of the ones that we are called to love. Seriously. And I look at it like this. Any man of God that's worth his salt, if he has given his life for that church and he goes home to be with the Lord, the least we could do is make sure that his wife and his kids are okay. Now, you know, we may not be able to support them 100% financially, but man, give them respect, give them love, give them support, give them whatever you can give them. But don't ever cast them aside and act like they were never apart. And I'm telling you, man, it's a shame. It's a shame how we do. So I'm going to read this scripture. He was a burning and shining light, and we were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. And that's how it is, man. When God gives us gifts, when God gives us people, when God, you know, anoints us for a certain time in the season, and God forbid we go home to be with the Lord early. And people, man, they see our lives. That's why it's so important, man, to live our life. To live the life that God has given you and to be unique in that life. God has not called you to conform, but he called you to be transformed. Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. And what that means is, you know, be transformed. Be a new creation. Be that man and woman of God that God has called you to be, and don't be a duplicate of anyone else. Because I ain't going to lie, you could call yourself having spiritual sons, but every spiritual son should have the trait of his father. But at the end of the day, he should not be a duplicate of his father, because the father, he's the foundation. But upon that foundation, you build up and you make it better. My goal is, I want my sons, they have my traits, but I want them to be better than me. When it comes to ministry, when it comes to marriage, when it comes to anything. Have a career that's better than me. Have more money than I've ever had. Do what I could not do, because that is the standard. That is what I want you to do. I don't want you to be like me. I don't want you to duplicate my life. I want you to have a life that's better. I gave you this life so that you could have a better one. And I want you to do the same for your kids. That's my goal. Seriously, that's my goal. That's my goal as a man. And the crazy part about it is that we have to live better than we preach. I'm serious. My pastor told me that. He said, Leon, anybody can preach, but we have to begin to live better than we preach. And that means having personal integrity. That means making sure that our marriages are 100, making sure that nobody, you know, people are going to come. They're going to say all kinds of stuff against you. But at the end of the day, the only opinions that should matter should be God's and your family's. Seriously, everybody else is optional and people are going to talk. But I look at it like this. You control the narrative. If there's dirt out here, you control the narrative. You say it first. You tell your story first, because can't nobody tell a story better than you, especially if it has to do with you. So I look at it like this, man. Be the one. Be the one that God has called you to be. But know this. That when you are praying for other people, that there is a responsibility. God does hear our prayers, but there is a responsibility. And sometimes, man, it doesn't go the way that we want. I ain't gonna lie. When I heard the news about Kobe Bryant, I was like, Lord, please, you know, let it, you know, I don't want that to be the case. You know, I didn't want no loss of life. You know, I was like, Lord, I just hope that that's fake news, because, I mean, it's been fake news out here. I was hoping that. Seriously, I was. But when it came out, I just shook my head. I was like, man, that don't make no sense. You know, because I look at it, it's not a full life. It wasn't a full life with Bruce Lee. It wasn't even a full life with Brandon Lee. I'm serious. But you know, I look at it like this. Like I said, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And the one thing I'm going to tell you about grief is that you can't rush it and you can't force it. It's a process that you have to go through. I'm serious. Whether you're grieving over a loved one, whether you're grieving over a relationship, you got to give your time and yourself. You got to have time to grieve and you got to allow your heart to vent. But the one thing I will say is that God is faithful. And the one thing that we all understand about life is that life is seasonal and that no season lasts forever. Seriously. And no season stays the same. And so, you know, it rains on the just as well as the unjust. So my prayer right now is, Lord, you know, be with our NBA players. You know, be with the ones who were close to Kobe Bryant. Be with the family, Lord God, of Whitney Houston. Be with the family, Lord God, of you know, Bruce Lee's family. Be with Tupac's family. Be with, you know, Biggie's family. Be with all of our celebrities' families. Save them, heal them, deliver them, Lord. Be with our families. Because I'm going to tell you, man, whoever expects, you know, nobody ever expects that one day, you know, you say, oh, hey, son, I'll see you when you get in here from school and your son don't make it home. Nobody ever expects that. You know what I mean? And I'm going to tell you, man, even when you driving, like, you know, my personal thing, like, man, I wasn't expecting no car accident. Here it is. I'm in a car accident in the beginning of January. I'm like, wasn't expecting it at all. But I thank God that I was able to walk away. But it didn't make sense. I'm like, Lord, this does not make sense. And I'm going to tell you, man, a lot of things ain't going to make sense. But I look at it like this, that all things are possible to him that believes. The Bible says that it rains on the just as well as the unjust. But through it all, man, through our God, we shall do valiantly. It is he who will tread down the enemy. We will sing and shout the victory. Hallelujah. That is us. But I will say this, man. Sometimes we have questions that may not be answered. But also know this, that the enemy comes not, but he comes to kill and to steal and to destroy. But Jesus said, I come that you might have life and have that more abundantly. So we got to understand, man, that there is a devil out here who wants to try to wreck us all, whether saved or unsaved. Seriously, his whole agenda is making a mockery out of the Son of God. And you got to understand who you are. And the biggest weapon that he uses against us is, have God said, if thou be the Son of God. So I want you guys to understand, man, that God is with us. And this is probably be the most solemnest, quietest, and most somberest video that I may ever do. Because I ain't gonna lie, it don't make no sense. I'm serious. It doesn't make any sense where we are right now. But I look at it like this. Sometimes things have to get worse before they can get better. You know, with our country, you know, in our homes and our communities. But I look at it like this. In order for newness to take place, sometimes, you know, a seed has to drop into the ground and it has to die. And it has to die because of the pressure, because of the darkness. But when that seed springs up, it springs forth light. It springs forth because of the light. It springs forth because of the life, the new life that it is. And it brings forth a harvest, 30, 60, and 100 fold. So don't be discouraged. I'm going to tell you, man, do not be discouraged, because God, he's going to give us a harvest of joy. He's going to give us a harvest of peace. He's going to give us a harvest even of understanding. And I'm going to tell you, man, some gifts are priceless and they will not be replaced. But the one thing that I love about the priceless gift that cannot be replaced is the memories. Live in the good of that memory. Live in the good of what these people were to us, what they represented to us, what they represented to community, man, what they represented, you know, to the institutions they were in. When we remember that, and we remember the strength, we remember the love, we remember the passion, their living will not be in vain. And so that is the one thing that we have to know and that we have to understand, is that, you know, in the world that we're going to have trouble. But the one thing that I love about the Lord, he says that you're going to have trouble, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And so the one thing that I love is that he is on the inside of us. And if he has overcome the world, that means we can overcome the world. We can overcome the pressure. We can overcome the burden. And it's not hopeless. Where there's life, there is hope. And so I want you guys to know, man, don't ever allow your heart to grow dark. And don't ever allow yourself to think that it's totally hopeless, or that, you know, God don't understand. He is easily touched with the feelings of our infirmities. And he knows our tears. He knows our tears. So, hey, I want you guys to pray. You know, pray for each other. Pray for your families. Pray for our country, because our country is looking like it's getting ready to be divided. Pray for our country, because we have to begin to stand for truth. We got to begin to stand for humanity. We cannot allow our country to go to the enemy. And what I mean by the enemy, we cannot allow the enemy to take away our heart and take away our passion and take away our humanity. Because if we lose that, what good are we? We will kill without conscience. We will take and put up all kinds of laws without conscience. And we won't even look at each other as brothers. And we will allow blood to be spilled in the street, and we won't even care. So we got to get to the place, man, where we have to pray and we have to begin to allow God's love to lead us and to guide us. The word of the Lord says, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples indeed, if you have love one towards another. Jesus said it, that men shall know that we are his, that we are his disciples when we have love towards another. So we got to stop killing each other in church. The Bible says that they shall scourge you in the synagogue. They will whoop you in church. But I'm going to tell you right now, man, and that they will think that they are doing God's service. So we got to do better, because there's a spirit of deception that is out here today. There's a spirit of control, a spirit of religion out here today that just wants to control people and manipulate people and not give them the truth to be free in your mind, to know that God is on the inside of you, to know that you are the prophet of your life, that you are the pastor of your life. Because if you listen to your own words, you will believe your own words just as you believe the pastor's words, just as you believe the prophet's words. You are your own prophet. You, the biggest prophet is you, because you believe what you say. And I'm going to tell you this, what happens in the mind will happen over time. And so if you keep dwelling on a certain thing, you keep meditating on a certain thing, that thing going to come to pass. Seriously, that thing going to come to pass, whether it be good or bad. You know, the Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. So we got to begin, man, to change our thoughts. And when you begin to change your thoughts, you'll change your life. Change your mind. Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. So we can do it. But it all starts. What are you willing to believe? Who are you willing to believe? Believe what the word of God says about you. Seriously. And I'm going to say this. It doesn't matter where you come from. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter what you've been involved in. God forgives you. He ain't mad at you. Seriously, he ain't mad at you at all. And he wants you to come to him. His whole MO is come on home. If you look at the parable of the lost son, the two sons are the church, the house of Israel, and the Gentiles. And the father is out there waiting for his son to come back home. Waiting for him to come back home. And that is what God is to us. And I'm going to do a what's the name on that. I know it ain't going to be tomorrow, so maybe Monday. I'm going to do a video just on that, on the parable of the prodigal son, because God has given me a revelation about that. And I want to share it with you guys. But let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for today. We ask right now, Lord God, that you will be with the Bryant family, that you will be with his teammates, that you will be with those who are close to him, Father, Lord God. And that, Father, we thank you, Lord, that you will also be with us. Be with in our homes, Lord God. Be with our loved ones, Lord God. Even those that we have lost. I ask right now that you begin to heal the hurt, heal the pain. And that, Lord God, grief will not stay longer than it's supposed to. But, Lord, we know that grieving is a process. But, Lord, we thank you that your word says that weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning. So, Father, I thank you for the morning season. I thank you, Father, Lord God, that you've even taken us through the night season. And so, Father, we thank you, Lord, that this is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. And we thank you, Lord, that these people were special to us, that they held a special place in our hearts, and we will not forget the memory of them. We will not forget the gift that they are, the gift that they were, the gifts that they left us, Lord God, the memories, Lord God, the impartations. We will not forget. And so, Father, we thank you. I just ask that you just touch every listener, every viewer, Lord God, every person that shares this. We thank you, Lord God, that you are sending a special healing to them right now. And let them know, Lord God, that it is okay. Let them know that they are forgiven. Let them know, Lord God, that you are with them. And also let them know that you care and that you hear, the cries of their heart. In Jesus' name, amen. So I want you guys, hey, to be blessed. I want you to enjoy this Super Bowl. I am rooting for Kansas City. And the reason why I'm rooting for Kansas City is because Andy Reid is there. He was in Philly. And even though Philly's not in it, I'm not going to lie. I'm like, this is a year without Tom Brady. I'm like, whoo, wow. I never thought that'd be. I'm serious. I just thought, you know, Super Bowl Tom Brady. Who they going against this year? But it's not like that. So I'm like, wow, man. You know, Kansas City and San Francisco. I'm like, wow. That I ain't going to lie. I actually thought, man, Baltimore would be. I thought the Ravens. I'm serious. I thought the Ravens. I'm serious. I was like, yeah, you know, if I had to be a betting man, I would say the Ravens. You know, the Ravens probably be in there or Seattle probably be in there. You know what I mean? But it didn't happen that way. I'm serious. It didn't happen. I even thought that the Texans were going to be in there, but it didn't happen that way. So, you know, enjoy your families, man. Serious, life is precious, man. Life is like a vapor. Enjoy your families. Love on them. Tell them that you love them. Invest in them, man, because the one thing that money cannot buy time. And at the end of your life, the one thing that you wish that you had was more time. And the people that you want by your side is your family. Seriously. So I look at it like this, man. Lord, thank you for my life. Thank you for my life. I am grateful for everything that you have given me, everything that you have done for me. Thank you. Everything that you brought me through, Lord God, thank you. So I'm done. And I will say this, God has opened up another door. We are actually on iHeartMusic now with the podcast. So I'm just trying to figure out, all right, Lord, I love doing these Facebook Live videos, but I'm going to have to really get out here, man, and put this podcast together because doors have opened up on that I wasn't even expecting. I'm serious. I wasn't even expecting it at all, but I mean, door after door after door after door. And I just, Lord, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. So I want to encourage you guys to check out my book, Let No Man Put Asunder, Kick the Clergy Out Your Bedroom. It is on Amazon. You can get it in Kindle form. You can get it in paperback form, or you can get it from me because I'm going to be doing book signings here in Wilmington and throughout Delaware. We're just going to be all over this year, and we are going to come with the message of reconciliation, but also the message of being responsible and accountable in your marriage and taking it back from the enemy, taking it back from convictions that are not biblical based. Because, man, people are throwing stuff out here and they trying to tell you it's Bible and it ain't. I'm telling you, man, if there's no scripture that can back up the revelation, it's personal conviction. That's all it is. So be aware and beware. All right. Thank you. I love you guys. Peace.